Hi, everyone. My name is Pavel. I am CEO and the founder of Unnyhog. It might sound obvious, but we make video games. Our team has been working together for 5 years already. And so far, we have developed and released 3 games for mobiles and PC, which were downloaded more than 5 million times. Today, we are working on a brand new game called Uniworld. Uniworld is a massively multiplayer online game which takes the best from Clash of Clans and League of Legends and allows both PC and mobile users to play together. Welcome to the fantasy. In the beginning, you will pick up one of many characters to play. Your avatar lives on a tiny planet which you control. Your goal is to build and evolve your planet and the character. There are millions of other players around you, and you will travel to other planets to fight with them. Now, let me show you our secret sauce. There are no buttons on the screen anymore to control your character. So to cast all spells, you just need to use simple gestures like taps, swipes, and draw different symbols. Everything is very fast, simple, and intuitive. There is no GUI between you and the game anymore, so you can feel real magic in your fingers creating all those spells with only your hands. This is the revolution in the way how you control things. We have created extremely dynamic battles in real time on any device. You can start playing this game on PC and later continue playing it on your mobile. You can invite your friends to play with you even if you are playing from different devices. You can go to arena and check your skills against other players in real time. Or create guild and dive together with your friends into dungeons, fighting powerful monsters. Our game is the first, truly cross-platform, fast-paced online game. Welcome to Uniworld, the first of its kind. As a summary, Uniworld is a cross-platform game where each player has equal chances to win. It became possible because of our gesture control system. On the top of that, we keep our sessions short, about 5 minutes, and we are targeting esport. We have been working on this game for more than 2 years already. In the beginning, no one believed in us, but we didn't give up. And recently, we found great investors who invested in our team and in Uniworld specifically. We also have the best mentors who work for famous companies. They all believe in us and support us. Uniworld is in closed beta right now. If you want to try it, sign up on the website or come talk to me. I have it on my devices. As the next step, we are working on retention and monetization right now by adding much more content and improving other basic KPIs. When the game is ready, we are launching it worldwide. Thank you.
Hi. So my question, how do you plan to monetize it on different platforms?
Sure. It's a free-to-play game. So monetization is very close to what Clash of Clans and League of Legends has. So you can buy different boosts to get new stuff instantly instead of waiting, or skins for your character, for your planet.
In terms of the world itself, what's the tech tree look like for that? Because it looked like a very small planet that you exist with, on, but you showed a vast number of landscapes. So does the planet get bigger as you grow?
No, the planet is big enough for you, actually, for many levels. Each player gets his tiny planet under his control, but on a certain level, you will be able to travel and capture other planets under your control, so you can build like a system of the planets.
So you put esports on there, right? Which is kind of the big keyword right now. Everyone is putting that everywhere. I see MMO, I see collaborative gameplay. How does that factor into esports?
We have many characters. Each of them has its own abilities. So it's easy to start game, but very hard to master because you need to team up with certain characters, with your friends, for example, and plan your strategy, how you will play on arena in real time. That's where we put esports.
So what do you think the most important aspect to retain the user for this game?
You mean on which aspect we need to work right now to make it The biggest challenge right now is arenas. We need to make arena as interesting as possible, so it will be replayable as many times as League of Legends map, for example. And the biggest challenge right now is that we are testing on a small portion of users. And in most cases, our CCU is very low, so people have to play with bots instead of users. And it's not as fun as playing with other real players. But it's just a question of time when we will be ready to get more users. Thank you.
My name is Ilya. I'm from Russia. And I would like to present to you our game called Lord Monster 2. First of all, our team, we have your typical two pizza team. We have 7 people online, 2 programmers for client, 2 programmers for server, 1 lead designer, 1 game designer, and 1 producer. And our first game, which was called Lord Monster 1, it was released in 2008 for feature phones. The iPhone has just appeared, and the feature phones with buttons, with tiny screens, dominated the market. It was also online real-time PvP, built on Java with a very tight technical limitations. And we launched it worldwide for 9 languages, and it brought home 3 times more money than we spent on its creation. So we know how to monetize these kind of games, how to make them interesting. And based on this game, we decided to launch the next one, the Lord Monster 2. So I would like to play in-game video, if possible. Our current game, it is built on Unity, so it runs both on mobile devices and on web, in social networks, and we have soft launched it in the most popular Russian social network, VK. So, any problem with it? Thank you. So, the game looks like this. You control the player, you see other players on the world map. When you encounter a computer or human player, you can engage in a fight. This clip was created some 3 months ago, so the graphics has improved since. So you have your typical MMO, you have your hero, you can improve him, you fight, you get some loot out of fight, get money, get experience, improve your character, you can improve, upgrade your items, your weapons, you can hire more armies. Players can unite into clans, and clans control the cities. And in the game, we have the really huge game world divided into the kind of islands that you can teleport between. We don't have a city builder in the game, so the player is free to roam the game world to discover new lands, form new alliances, and find other players. So the combat is turn-based, and when you play with the real person somewhere on Earth, it's really, really interesting and engaging. So now back to my desk. Oh, the final one. Okay. So the main city, main game cycle is typical for RPG games. You battle, you get loot, you upgrade. And this is what the game dynamics looks like. So on the early levels, you mainly busy improving yourself. Then you have your clan activities and stuff like that.
The other game was launched in 2008, and you made a comment that you saw revenues of roughly 3 times the expense of building the game. But what are your live costs like? I mean, did you account for that when you were saying that it made 3 times of what you put into it?
Sorry, what was our what?
your live costs, so your expense for maintaining and operating the game.
Yeah, actually, maintaining it was not so costly. We had a live team of roughly 2 to 3 people, adding new levels, new game content, players that, and they also technical support. So it really was not expensive to run.
So what is your monetization model?
We have 4 ways to monetize the game, all of the experience of the previous one. First of all, we have hard currency in the game, and that can be spent on resurrecting the army in case you lose. So it's not such a pain if you lose. You just can resurrect them all for hard currency. Second, you can use it for teleportation between locations to make discovery easier. Third, you can buy items and weapons that otherwise unavailable to for you. And lastly, you can use hard currency to speed up your development. And that's 4 points that players like to pay for, from our experience.
That experience is based on your previous game?
Yes. For example, we discovered that players don't like to personalize the hero that we originally thought, but they don't like it.
So when is the, what is the release time?
Sorry?
What is the time frame for the launch of this game?
Time for the launch? Well, we soft launched in Russia in a social network VK, and we expect another 6 months to further develop the game from this moment, to add some game content, to add clan activities. And in 6 months, we want to launch worldwide.
Self-publishing at the moment?
Sorry?
Self-publishing? Or you're launching globally with a partner?
We would like to launch globally.
So how did you do user acquisition in 2008? And how much do you think that's applicable today to this new game?
No, this is, I think it's not applicable because, you know, all the models have changed, and this was a Java game. We got featured on Nokia OV Store, and we have some good third-party stores or platforms, web platforms, that brought us a lot of users.
So how much of the community you still have today of the first game?
For the first game? Well, we have some 100,000 registration, and the active players, I believe, in thousands. And we tested the new games, the new game on them, because it runs on iOS, Android, and on web, and they accepted it well. Okay, thank you.
We are a Hong Kong-based mobile game company, and our game currently we're right now Mini Legend. It's a racing simulation game based on iOS and Google Android. It's been out in Hong Kong since December 2014. And then recently, the last month and a half, we've been launching it in Southeast Asia. And we're doing quite well. Give you a summary. It's a racing simulation game based on the Mini four-wheel drive model toy. It's been a very popular toy in the 90s across Asia. And our game's a simulation game. And here are some screenshots of some of our artwork. What this game does is you can mod different type of cars, the body, chassis, and different types of parts. And you can race it against multiplayer. There's a story mode, there's a time attack mode. And we've actually been doing a lot of different promotions with both online and offline. And here are some of the cars you see. We actually put some localized content, such as a Hong Kong taxi and a Hong Kong minibus. As well, we're working with a lot of local designers that design cars for us. Some of them are actual car designers. And these are upcoming cars for our game. We have an RPG mode. It's like a story mode. These are all the characters in it. And then you play through and you level up your character and your car as you go along the way. And currently we have over 120 different levels for each of the story mode. Let's see. And the gameplay. And it's a modifying game, and what you've done is a very stat-based game. Each part corresponds to a different stat in your game. As you upgrade your parts, the faster your car go. and it's in a slotted back, so it's not like a remote control car. You do not control during the game. You have a launch mode, and we have some other additional power-ups that allowed you to speed through the tracks. And for the multiplayer, right now we have a one-on-three, so three-player can asynchronously play this game. Since it's very stat-based, even if you're not online, you can still compete against other people. We're very heavily monetized. Performance you see here are in-app purchases. We've been actually grossing very well. Our average revenue per paid user is over $100 US, and that's within each month. We have in the top grossing for racing category in all of our release regions. That includes Hong Kong, Macau, Singapore, Malaysia, Vietnam, Indonesia, Thailand. And currently for all the Southeast Asian versions, it's all English, and we're working with different publishers to bring it to other regions. Actually, I can show you a video clip of what our game looks like. And this is actually recently an ad that we've been putting on YouTube, and we've been featured on both Google and iOS. We're actually featured right now on the Hong Kong store on Google, and then we're getting featured next week in Singapore. And here is this is one of the ads that we're playing right now.
And this is localized in Cantonese.
Not the fastest.
爆四驅車, 挑戰online對手, 成為至尊王者, 四驅傳說現已免費下載.
So the game is live now on the release regions, and we're working on to releasing it in Taiwan end of this month. And for mainland China, we're actually dealing with different publishers right now to bring it there.
So $100,000 average per?
No, 100.
100, okay.
US dollars.
Okay, that's not bad.
Yeah, yeah.
The target audience that you mentioned earlier on, any specific reason why you limit to male only? That's like leaving 50% on the table.
Yeah, because mainly we've done a lot of studies on this game. We've done a lot of Facebook, and most of our, basically 80 to 90% of our users are male, between the ages of 25 to 35. One of the reasons is this was a very popular toy back in the 90s, and actually a lot of them are around the 30s right now. And a lot of them have extra money to spend, but they don't have the time to play these real hobby. It's a physical hobby. So for them, going back to the game and playing it through a digital version, it's much more time effective for them. So that's why through our marketing and through the data we've collected, most of our demographic is in the male category. That's why we focus most of our marketing resources on males.
Congratulations on your success so far. That's fantastic. Now, this having been a toy in the 90s, do you have licensing issues to deal with?
No, it's like remote control cars. It's a genre in general. So there are licenses, such as one of the big companies that make is Tamiya. They're one of the leading companies that make this type of toy. But then there's also Chinese companies like Oddly that also make similar toys. So there's no licensing for this genre. It's like having a model car, but then you got different type of companies that make model cars.
Can you share a bit more information about the retention number, and also not just average paying user per paying user, but what is the adult and stuff like that?
Okay, our retention, our second-day retention drops to around half, and then
what is the percentage?
50, half.
Just 50.
Yeah. So around 7 days, we are down to around 14-15%. And then our ARPU, like not average revenue paid, but like ARPU is around $1.40, yeah, US. So around that. We have around 120,000 users right now. And that's from a lot of them are from Southeast Asia because we just launched. But in Hong Kong, we have around 40,000.
What's the target market like, assuming you go big? What would be the target market since it's based on an Asian kind of a hobby phenomenon?
You mean like total amount of people?
Yeah, kind of which countries?
Okay. Actually, one of the big ones is Taiwan. They actually have been using VPN to download our game. We're actually making a big launch end of this month, We're working with some of the big media agencies, companies in Taiwan to launch it. And we expect that to be around four times the amount of people that are playing now. That's the main big market. Also, China is also quite a big market. And one of the origins of this toy is from Japan. So we're actually talking with some Japanese publishers.
So your game is based on a toy from some time ago, and now you made it into a game. Do you plan to make it full circle and start doing merchandise toys again?
Yes, we've actually been dealing with some mainland toy factories. And we're actually discussing with them on whether or not we can bring it, you know, bring the toy back. Another thing is, because 3D printer is very popular right now, a lot of them, all these designs are in-house made and designed by us, other than the some of the ones that I was talked about, we actually got designers to hop on and help us out. And a lot of them do real modeling, so they were thinking of bringing it to, like using 3D printers to bring it to life as well.
So what kind of items players are paying the most?
Paying?
Yeah.
Everything. Because the wheel affects the speed, the RPM, the motor affects, you know, the overall speed, and you need the stays to pin down the car, the aerodynamics of the body. So I can't just get a motor and think that I can win everything, because you can go really fast, but you don't have the proper aerodynamics to push down your car, you're going to fly off the track. So every single part, that's why our paying users pay so much, is because they got a nice motor, now they get a nice body, they get a nice chassis to everything, you know, to go with the whole car. And for our next update, we're actually updating we're adding a parts shop so that people can pay straight up cash to buy certain starter packs. Because our game's been out for several months in Hong Kong, and some people just hopped on, some of the newbies, they think that, oh, it's hard for me to collect everything from scratch. So we're like, okay, here we go, here's a starter pack with three motors, two bodies, chassis, wheel, everything to get you started for so-and-so dollars. You can hop on in the game right now. And our grossing, our revenue has been going up recently because we've been optimizing our monetization, so it's been doing quite well.
So I missed part of the presentation. Is it like a single player?
Oh, it's an online player. You can play single player through the story mode, but most of the action's in the PvP part. So we have a weekly rankings that have it's a global ranking, so it's not by region. And then there's also a daily ranking for best time lap times that we give gifts out. And then now our next update in the summer coming out is the team race. So we have a friend system now where you can like play against friends. It's kind of like Clash Royale. You can challenge friends. And the next step to that is having teams. So you know it's like Team Hong Kong versus Team Taiwan. And then I can have like me and two other friends versus someone from another country. So we're pulling that out in around August, I think. Yeah.
Did I hear correctly? You have 120,000.
Yes.
Users, monthly active users.
Downloads. Before we soft launched in Hong Kong, and then we kept the traffic minimal to test the game, and then the last 1 month or so, 1.5 months, we released it in multiple regions in Southeast Asia. So 120,000 within the first month and a half, 2 months.
MAU,
just roughly. Sorry. What's the MAU? MAU is around 40,000, I think. 40,000 right now. Yeah. And daily active users around 5,000-6,000, I think. Daily active user. Yeah. And then the paying users around a little over 1%.
Great. Thanks.
All right. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Dozan. I'm chieftain/CEO from Joyseed Gametribe. You see game developer based on Jakarta, Indonesia. Maybe my presentation a little bit different from the another. We want to explain about our vision. First, we come from the problem. First, I think joy is needed. Daily routine makes us stress. Second, individual. People nowadays become more individual, less interaction with each other. Third is bad reputation. Game has a bad reputation for some people. Four, lost value. Some developers just focus to get the money as much as they can. They forget about the game itself. They just develop the fan service, super sexy character or another. So here we are. We are a Joyseed Gametribe. We have three value proposition. We believe high quality product can be enjoyed by people. And second, games with value. We believe game as media. It can be good, it can be bad. It depends on the people who play it. So why we don't try to make the game with the value. The game can give message and inspire the people. And the last thing is the community. Community is our top priority, and we believe multiplayer is the best fit for the community. Maybe we can skip this one.
Is it working?
Here's our first product. Daydream the Beginning. Daydream the Beginning is endless arcade game with flawless beauty of art and design. In this game, we must press the correct button, and we must press the color of the enemy. And they have the time limit, so we must press the as fast as we can. This game is story about young shepherd Mondo. This boy is young shepherd. He just shepherd boy, but he has a big dream. He has a big dream of become a great knight. So despite he doesn't have a fighting skill, he brave enough to chase his dream to become a great knight. Platform we developed in the mobile and tablet, and how we monetize is from ads, video ads, and in-app purchase. So we have some feature like leaderboard, achievement. We have many custom, and that will be artbook download. We developed this well, so we have the artbook in PDF. The player can be download it. Our milestone. Last one, we got the best game art in Indie Game Festival in Indonesia, 2016. Here's some screenshot. And here are our model. Premium game, from Toys Merchandising, for an additional expansion pack, 5 with crowdfund, and 6 from intellectual property. It's our long-term goal. Here's our team. It's me. I'm Wirosan. Here's my works. The second is we have Joseph Putra. He's our art director. Here's this work. And here's our programmer. The name is Yedia Juan. And the last, we have Tommy Prayogo as the artist. Maybe I can give you more about Daydream. Yeah, it's Daydream. Simple game design with flawless beauty of art and design. Here's our target market. We have primary target market in 21 and 35 years old in US and Europe, and they have high mobilization using mobile game, casual gamer, play games to killing time or for waiting in the MRT or a bus, and they usually busy. We have the secondary target market is 12 to 21 years old, male or female, start student and using mobile gadget, more playing time, and they playing mobile games. We have 4 main selling points. First, high quality art and design. Second is this game for killing time, high replayability. You play, die, repeat again, just for the killing time, killing your time. And we have the character and story value driven. And we have the collectible costume and download art book. Maybe here are monetized. We monetize. The Dream Beginning is free to play model, and we have main monetized in ads, the banner ads from several retry, and we have video ads for free money. To player get the costume, and we have in-app purchase too. If player doesn't want to wait patient to collect the money, they can buy it. For instance, and here from screenshot, and here's the development. Thank you.
So, have you started the development yet?
Yes, it's our first game. There's a pre-alpha. We are already in pre-alpha. We still small team.
How big is team? Just the all the, how many people total?
We have 4.
Just 4.
4, and honestly, to be honest, just me is in full time. The other have a full-time job, another full-time job.
When do you think you're going to release the game, or like?
The development is in 80%, I think. So there's some bug and tutorial, and maybe we can launch it in August. Yeah.
It's your target market.
Target market?
Asia.
We want to reach the US and Europe because they have shared the same taste. They're more have the global market taste, you know. And we try to target.
Based on your experience,
yes?
Do you think this game monetize better with ad or versus IAP?
I think, to be honest, it's my first game. I never released another game before. So, but after we analyze and try to figure it out, I think the best fit it is ads from ads. It can get the more revenue, but it maybe need the more download.
So you are planning to launch already in August. So that is 3 months away.
Yes.
Yes. So what are you doing already for marketing? Are you self-publishing? Are you talking to publishers? What's your plan to
do? To be honest, we're looking for publisher because we doesn't have promotional funds. So we think the best fit is looking for publisher. So they can up our apps.
Yeah, a publisher certainly will help you, especially with in-network users, which can help launch your game quite a bit more cheaply. But that sort of speaks to what are you doing in terms of adding social features or multiplayer features to the game?
Like I said before, multiplayer is our value, right? But I think our team is too small to develop like that. So we want to develop small games, but executable. We want to develop small and simple game, but we totally develop in this, in art and design, and we try the best. But we believe we will try to develop team too, so the game itself, so our team can be grow and the ready for the multiplayer game for our next game, maybe two or three our next game. Because to be honest, it's very difficult to develop multiplayer for if we look the our team right now.
Assuming that you get a publisher, right, who ups your game, this game specifically, what do you think is the maximum addressable market? Like, how many people, based on your research, could you reach?
We hope we have 1 to 10,000 user download maybe. Okay, thank you.
Hello and welcome. Let me show you our town. People don't believe that every single person can become a hero. Town is a stage where ordinary people strive to find a way to the portal of remembering. Through endless combat, adventures, and self-improvement, they are awakening their inner strengths and reclaiming long-lost superpowers. Our heroes are not supernatural creatures. They're ordinary people from your neighborhood, like a butcher, granny, or chimney sweeper. Although they look unremarkable, their hidden powers are far from ordinary. Meet Gram Lucinda. Her religion is cooking, her sanctuary is kitchen, but in her secret life, she is a hardcore politician. To defend her neighborhood, she shoots a meatballs from the ladle, throws a cake with dynamite candles, and when she is really angry, even her denters will start attacking enemies. To awaken the hero within, she has to become the best Tombola player in the world. If you still haven't guessed, Awakening of Heroes is a MOBA game, but not yet another MOBA game. Awakening of Heroes is an action-packed MOBA game designed primarily for mobile devices without neglecting desktops. So we've used proven MOBA mechanics, trimmed the fat, made it more arcade, more dynamic, more viral, and more accessible for a wider audience. Let me show you what the game looks like. Besides leagues, Awakening of Heroes offers built-in casual tournaments, which allows players to play in a daily tournament without having pre-made teams. Each tournament takes up to 1 hour with the three matches up to 15 minutes each. Awakening of Heroes will make competitive scene more accessible and bring esport and tournament into every home. We want for every gamer and gaming enthusiast to be able to participate and compete. Cross-platform streaming allows players, broadcasters, to stream their own matches or spectate other matches on mobile devices and desktop. Twitch Play turns passive viewers into active participants, and their votes will trigger various events inside of the match, like a rain of power-ups, and allow them to have influence inside of the match. Awakening of Heroes also supports Oculus Rift. Game is free to play with in-game purchases. Players can buy different skins and heroes for the arena. They can buy different time savers and enhancements to faster town development, or buy additional cards to speed up hero adventure discovery. On top of that, they can subscribe for a premium account and have various benefits in each aspect of the game. With 8 people in our team, we have all major roles covered. In the past, COFA Games developed 2 games as a work for hire. I'm in IT industry for 15 years, and before COFA Games had founded a web development company which executed more than 300 projects. We started with game development in 2014 as a self-funded company, and now we are getting into closed beta phase. We've been recognized by the European Innovation Fund with €80,000 grant, and Twitter grant of €50,000, which will be used in a soft launch phase. We also participated in Startup Sona Accelerator program in Finland, and we won Best Game in Show Casual Connect Award last year. We managed to build a very active and engaged community with more than 50,000 registered alpha subscribers. We are in development. We are following lean methodology as much as possible. We are testing game constantly and improving based on community feedback. We're looking for half a million investment to help us accelerate game development and grow globally. My name is Nikola. Please check our website and fan page and stay awake. Heroes are coming soon. Thank you.
So what can you do with the 500,000?
500,000, it's for game completion. Now we're in a closed beta phase, so we need several months to complete it. There are ongoing costs, so we want to cover one next year to don't worry about development costs. There are ongoing costs like servers. They're one of actually the biggest expense because it's a multiplayer game. We have to cover different zones, different regions. For soft launch as well, so we have all the funds that we can use from Twitter for a grant, but on top of that, we want to use those funds for a soft launch. Soft launch in general should be mixed of YouTube streamers plus a little bit of user acquisition. So our focus is mainly on community marketing, as I mentioned. So please, next question. So
yeah, what's the current size of your audience? Active players?
Size, it's 15,000 registered alpha subscribers. Game is not public yet. It's closed alpha stage. So that audience is mostly used for play testing. We are playing each week. They're giving us feedback, and based on that, we're improving game.
How did you recruit them?
Mostly through YouTube broadcasters. So that's our strength. As I mentioned, it's cross-platform, so you can play on mobile, and I can stream it on desktop. And there is a Twitch Play that I mentioned as well. Actually, viewers from Twitch chat, they can trigger events inside of the game. So that made the game a little bit more viral, and that's how we got users.
Thank you.
Hello, everyone. My name is Benoît Freslon. I'm French, and I'm a game designer. I'm a solo indie game developer since 2007, and I try to make different games. Sometimes I ask freelance to work on my games because I can't do everything on my games, you know. I started to design games when I was 9. I created a board game with Lego style, and the feature was when when you put items, real items, on figurines, the characteristics can change. That feature was really cool. My friend loved it. But my first video game, indie video games, was Nanowar. It was a real-time strategy game. If you remember, in 2007, there was a lot of tower defense games. Remember, in Flash. So I see a lot of kind of games. I see people can play strategy game, OK? So I will try to make a fast-paced action, real-time strategy game with online multiplayer. And I also developed the mobile version. 20 million plays, that's cool. And the second series was unbelievable because I just started to make a game in 7 days with the ideas, play with your computer, play with what you have in front of you, in front of the player. The keyboard, the microphone, the video camera, etc., etc. This game was played 40 million times on the web because I developed the Flash version. You can play with all your environment. Then I developed the Android, the iOS version 3 years ago. And the possibilities are really, really insane because the mobile is rich. You can play with every features. It's amazing. I will show you a video.
Hello, my name is Benoît. I'm the developer of Enigbox. In Enigbox, you need to think and play outside the box to solve 54 creative puzzles. This game is really unique because it uses all the player environments in the gameplay. I wanted to create an amazing game experience using all the features and the interaction offered by the mobile device. The goal of each level is to find the hidden heart. To find it, you will need to look for the hint. Every input of your mobile phone is a part of the game like this one. Your mobile is a tool you're using every day without even thinking. Those puzzles will make you use it in a way you're not used to, and will force you to get rid of your usual habits. Every puzzle is different and hides a new surprise. Here's one of my favorites, electromagnetic. If you put a metallic object near from your device, you can see the magic happens. It was really fun to design and to see people playing it during showcases. Play with your friend, your children, your family, and make your imagination rock. Thank you for watching.
So the next step is to make the Android version of the game because a ton of people ask me, why did you develop the Android version yet? I think I will have to add more puzzles inside. There is 54 puzzles. This game is a mix between a freemium and premium. You have like a demo, 9 puzzles for free, and you can come back every day and get 2 puzzles for free by watching video ads. Or you can buy the entire game for $2. And the next step is to port the game experience in Inbox on Steam. But I will try to make the game that I want because make a game by solo, it's really difficult. I think I will ask people to help me on that game. Thank you.
Do you get a lot of paying users or mostly free users?
Paying users, it's 1% paying users.
What is the monetization model? Like, what do users pay for?
It's a 50-50 ads and in-apps. The in-apps are really simple. You can pay for hints or unlock puzzles. And the video ads can get two levels per day. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Kelvin, and I'm from a company called Delta Duck Studio. So we do games beyond entertainment. We are a local company based here in Singapore, incubated under Game Solution Center. So we are a team of 7 people. I'm handling the business side. We have 1 programmer, 2 designers, and 3 artists. Just a brief overview of our portfolio. We co-developed some games. They were mostly focused on education, a puzzle platformer called GetZap, and Chiro Heroes, which was published with a book publisher called Marshall Cavendish. Other than that, we have self-published our other games. Last year, about 33 smaller games that have garnered over 1 million downloads across the board. But over the past 1 year, we've been working on our core title called Monster Chronicles. Monster Chronicles is a strategy role-playing game that is aims to be on a mobile platform, iOS and Android, and we aim to target mid to hardcore players. Monetization model is free-to-play, mostly with in-app purchases, and we are considering advertising too. Today, I'm going to share with you 3 key features of our game. Number 1, the battle system, progression, and how you can combine and customize monsters to make the gameplay more competitive and better for retention. First, our unique battle system. It is easy to learn, yet difficult to master. It's based on a 3x3 grid where you can swipe your monsters around to move them around to attack enemies or to move around and unleash different chain skills, which I will show you in the next demo video. So here's our demo. So those are called direct attacks, when monsters are swiped into each other, then they can move around the grid very easily, so it's easy to pick up and learn. And then there are also special attacks, when you form a chain, like a tic-tac-toe chain, a horizontal chain, it unleashes a chain skill, which is more like a team skill. So during the battle, players would move around and form different combinations in order to execute these different skills. And all these skills are executed automatically. Next is monster progression. So we have a variety of monsters, currently up to 71 monsters, and some of the monsters can evolve. So players would feel the need to collect these monsters and form their best party. Next, we can learn about 300 abilities, so each monster can learn up to 7 skills. 4 skills are combo skills. Whenever you directly attack enemies, you can have those skills. And 3 of the skills that each monster can learn are for chain skills. So when they form the chain, they can execute these skills. Other than that, we also offer endless customization by improving your monster's stats and characteristics by feeding them. And there's another thing called paths, which can be used and executed in battle or activated in battle to supplement your battle strategy. So we provide strategic depth in terms of the battle. Also, we want players to be retained and ensure competitive gameplay. So we took some elements of card games and have this thing called source transfer. Basically, when your monster reaches a certain level and you want to learn new skills from other monsters, you can do so by combining or fusing monsters together. And they can combine and learn and mix and match different skills. So the 7 skills can be transferable, transferred from one monster to another, to optimize your team to make them the strongest team. So this encourages competitive gameplay. So these are the 3 main features that I would like to share with you. And next, our monetization. Being a role-playing game, we have common currency, premium currency, and all these feeds into a gameplay where people will want to collect monsters and create their best team, and they can also customize the skill by collecting the best monsters and fusing them together, and also unlock different aesthetics, monster skins. Also, they can gacha puff pieces and gacha food items to feed their monsters or supplement their team to make it stronger during battles. That's the overview of our game. Our current development progress is as follows. So we are about 60 to 70% done, but we plan to soft launch in the Southeast Asia region around July, August this year. So with that, introduce my game. Any questions?
When you soft launch in July or August, what kind of retention numbers are you targeting?
I'm looking at Philippines first, Philippines or Thailand for now, so Southeast Asia.
Yeah, but what kind of numbers do you want to see in the soft launch to be happy and go ahead with the launch?
Okay, so currently I'm targeting about 5,000 to 10,000 users within first 2 weeks. I'll be using spending some money to acquire those users. Of course, there'll be organic growth, so it might go beyond those numbers. After that, I'll optimize. I'll look at people's feedback about the game, whether it progresses well, and look at the numbers. So for retention, we are looking at day one at 50%, day seven at 30%, and after 1 month, if it's 10%, we know that's about the benchmark there. If we do get a publisher, I'll check back with them. Maybe there are certain benchmarks that they have that they would like us to perform to their benchmarks. Then of course, we'll try to hit those numbers as well.
Which platforms are you targeting for post-launch?
Platforms, iOS and Android. So, okay, thank you very much.
So Alkemis Games is a gaming studio based in Surabaya, Indonesia, and we are founded in August of 2014. As a studio, we primarily focus on making games for the mobile platforms of iOS and Android, and we specialize in the mobile free-to-play mid-core genre. A few months after we started in August in 2014, we received a seed funding from a venture capital called East Ventures. So this is us in our cozy office. We are currently a team of 20 people, consisting of artists, animators, programmers, and designers / PMs. So far we have been working on our first title. It's called Raider's Quest, but before I talk about that, I would like to quickly go over our past experiences. So prior to Alkemis Games, I was at Gree International in San Francisco, and I was there. I joined initially as a software engineer and then moved on to a product manager, and I stayed there for 3 years. And the two games that I worked on is called Knights and Dragons and War of Nations. So these two games was considered a big success at Gree because even though it launched 4 years ago, it stayed in the top grossing even today consistently. So the core team members and the early members of Alkemis Games were from Square Enix Smileworks. So Square Enix Smileworks obviously is a company by Square Enix. It is actually based in Surabaya, the city that we're also based in. And unfortunately, it only lasted for 2 years, 2012 to 2014. And when I heard about the news, I was actually in Gree, San Francisco. And I reached out to the folks over at Square Enix Smileworks, and I asked them, hey guys, are you guys interested in starting something up? And that is basically how the idea of Alkemis started up. Okay, so earlier I mentioned the game that we're working on is called Raider's Quest, so here it is. This is an image from the game loading screen. And this is the screenshots off of our iTunes front page. So before I talk more about Raider's Quest, I'd like to show you a trailer, if possible. Let's see. Do you have sound?
Gaia, protect us!
Bring the world with the son of a gun!
Okay. So Raider's Quest is a full-fledged mobile free-to-play mid-core RPG. And the reason why I said full-fledged is because it has support for live ops and dev ops that supports live events. And why am I highlighting this? If there's one key takeaway that I learned from my days at Gree is that live events is super important in making sure that your mid-core game success is successful at the end of the day. And so we released Raider's Quest, we soft launched Raider's Quest in November of last year. And it started off in just one country, and right now it's available in 9 countries. And in those months, we have been continuously testing, tweaking, and balancing the game. And we've been presenting the KPIs and presenting it to different publishers. And eventually, last month, we finally signed a deal with our current publisher, which is called Tilting Point. And let me talk a little bit more about Tilting Point themselves. So they are a publisher based in New York. And just really wrap it up. So Tilting Point is our publisher. They're based in New York. You know, they have a lot of experiences, making games that have topped the top grossing, even top free and top grossing. And we'll be working with them to release Raider's Quest globally in September of 2016.
What markets are you targeting initially, and what platforms are you targeting initially?
So we're targeting both iOS and Android, right? but for the markets, we're targeting primarily the Western markets. But soft launches, for the nine countries that I mentioned, they include you know, Southeast Asia, we have Philippines, Singapore, Malaysia, and Australia, Canada for the high tier one, tier two countries, and also the Scandinavian countries to make up the rest of the nine. So that was mostly to test out the user acquisition cost and make sure that, you know, our artwork and, you know, whatever creatives that we use are actually selling well at a good price.
We'll pick one, hopefully more, presenter today to participate in our program. And thanks for everyone, and also our guest judges today, Georg, James, and Carly. So the program, just give you a quick highlight, we'll pick five winners at the end of our program to invest a total prize point value of $1 million to the studios, and with the publishing deals at the end. So we hope that we can discover the top talents in the gaming industry. Thank you so much.